Thank you. Welcome everybody to our afternoon tertulia. My name is Yarimar Bonilla. I am the director of the Center for Puerto Rican Studies at Hunter College, Centro. I'm very excited to welcome you to our event today. Today marks a historic occasion. On October 27th, 1974, there was a historic event at Madison Square Garden, bringing together the African-American community and the Puerto Rican community in the United States to support the decolonization of Puerto Rico. So to commemorate that event, we have a very special program for you today. We will be showing a small clip of a documentary about that event, where we'll get to see live footage from that moment. And we'll also hear from Representative Nidia Velasquez and from Juan Gonzalez, who are going to give us some reflections on the importance of that event. And then we will be hosting a panel discussion with James Early and Irma Lassén about the importance of that event for the present. Before beginning with that program, however, I would like to welcome who's really been a co-organizer for this event, Digna Sanchez, who will be providing some introductory remarks. Digna Sanchez was born in Arecibo, Puerto Rico, but raised in New York City. She is the founder of the Friends of Puerto Rico Initiative, which is one of the co-sponsors for today's event, along with Boricuas, Unidos, and La Diaspora. In addition to founding the Friends of Puerto Rico Initiative, Digna was also a member of the US chapter of the Puerto Rican Socialist Party. And it was in that role that she was one of the main organizers of the Solidarity event that took place on October 27th, 1974. Since 2014, she rematriated back to Puerto Rico, where she is currently involved with the Movimiento Independentista Ostosiano. So Digna, if I can ask you to turn on your camera and offer some introductory remarks for today's event.
I'm trying. Okay. Okay, there it goes. Saludos and greetings to everyone, and thank you, Yarimar, for that introduction. Today marks the 47th anniversary of the historic event in Madison Square Garden here in New York City, where 20,000 people gathered from across the United States and Puerto Rico in support of freedom for Puerto Rico and the five nationalist prisoners. During the 1960s, the United Nations had witnessed the decolonization of Africa. As that was happening, Puerto Rico had already been taken off the list of non-independent territories, when in 1952, the Estado Libre Asociado, known as the Commonwealth in English, was created at the behest of the United States. And the narrative that this represented an independent entity was created. In reality, Puerto Rico remained an unincorporated territory of the United States as stipulated in the US Constitution and remains that to this day. Puerto Ricans fought for freedom from Spain in the 1800s, but had not fully achieved it when the United States invaded Puerto Rico during the Spanish-American War in 1898. The debate and struggles associated with the status issue took on renewed emphasis after the establishment of the Estado Libre Asociado. The 1970s saw a generation of Puerto Ricans who grew up in the tenement housing projects and poor neighborhoods where their parents settled after leaving Puerto Rico in the late 40s and 50s. This was during the great migration of Puerto Ricans predominantly to the northeast of the US. This generation of which I am a part of grew up identifying with the civil rights struggles of African Americans and experienced racism and discrimination due to language and cultural differences with mainstream US society. The links between the Black community and the Puerto Rican community are extensive, and each community identified with each other's plight. Puerto Ricans are people of color and shared a history of slavery with all the suffering felt to this day. The unique difference between the struggle of the Black community and the Puerto Rican community is that our struggle is one based on the human rights of a nation that is dominated by another nation. This goes beyond civil rights to the human rights of a nation to its self-determination. The 70s were also the years of young people organizing against the Vietnam War and for women's rights. In this burgeoning activism, several Puerto Rican organizations developed, such as the Young Lords, El Comité, and the Puerto Rican Socialist Party. In addition to these groups, an important effort for consciousness raising was nurtured by the youth organization Aspira, founded by Dr. Antonia Pantoja in 1961. From the beginning, the groups organizing in the US saw themselves as part of the reality of Puerto Rico. Puerto Rican identity was a part of what had to be reinforced, and thus the struggles for Puerto Rican studies at the college level. Puerto Ricans in the diaspora began to see themselves as contributing to and essential for the movement for the decolonization and self-determination of Puerto Rico. Throughout those many decades from 1898 to 2016, it was only the pro-independent sector which said Puerto Rico was a colony of the United States. That has changed. And since 2016, all political forces in Puerto Rico agree that it is a colony of the United States. This is a pivotal shift and opens the issue of the decolonization of Puerto Rico to a broad alliance in Puerto Rico and in the United States. The October 27th, 1974 gathering was the largest event of its kind to date, and it took 2 years to accomplish through the efforts of the Puerto Rican Socialist Party and the Puerto Rico Solidarity Committees organized throughout the United States. The aim to break through the curtain of silence which mainstream media had on Puerto Rico was accomplished, and even the New York Times covered the event. It was a highly emotive outpouring of solidarity from all sectors of the people in the United States. The event was opened by the American Indian Movement, the original native people of what is now the United States, with their drummers welcoming all present to their land, which had been taken from them. The speakers brought together Black activists and communists, Angela Davis, and others such as civil rights icon Ella Baker. Juan Mariveras, the leader of the Puerto Rican Socialist Party, the organization which organized the event, also spoke. Today, 47 years from that first October 27th in 1974, we have all sectors in Puerto Rico in agreement that Puerto Rico is a colony. Conditions are set for a broad coalition of Puerto Ricans, our allies in the Black community, and progressives in the US to join in calling for an end to colonialism and for the self-determination of the people of Puerto Rico. That is the challenge we continue to face. I have no doubt that we will address the challenge and overcome it. Gracias.
Thank you, Digna. Thank you so much for those words. We will now go to our video package and then we will open up for our panel.
Good evening. I will first like to thank the Center for Puerto Rican Studies and Friends of Puerto Rico Initiative for inviting me to be a part of this important discussion. The history of Black American and Puerto Rican communities has been intertwined for many decades now. During the late 40s, 50s, and 60s of the last century, New York and Chicago saw an influx of Puerto Ricans seeking job opportunities after being displaced from rural jobs in Puerto Rico. Likewise, thousands of Black Americans fled from poverty in the South and chose New York as their new city. It was in this context when Black and Puerto Rican solidarity started to brew. The harsh conditions of working and living in a city that back then was not as welcoming to minorities fostered strong connections and relationships between Black American and Puerto Ricans. Decades later, these coalitions will translate into a political power that will ignite progress in major cities. Black candidates for mayor, such as out of Washington in Chicago in the 1980s, and David Dinkins in the 90s in New York City, fueled their campaigns by bringing the Black and Puerto Rican communities together to unite around the promise of a better future. And as I am sure this panel will discuss, one of the first concrete examples of alliances forming between Black Americans and Puerto Ricans can be traced back to 1959, when a campaign led by SEIU succeeded in securing union representation and collective bargaining rights in the city's municipal and private hospitals. At the time, 80% of hospital serving workers were Black and Puerto Ricans. Ever since, SEIU and the labor movement have been strong partners and advocates in fighting for the needs of Puerto Rican communities, not only on the mainland, but also on the island, which leads us today to the issue of self-determination. Earlier this year, I introduced H.R. 2070, the Puerto Rico Self-Determination Act of 2021, with Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez and more than 70 members in the House. In the Senate, we have bipartisan support for a companion bill led by Senator Bob Menendez. This bill became a reality thanks to the unwavering support of important community-based and national organizations, including SEIU and Black Lives Matter of Greater New York. Recently, BLM of New York sent a letter to the Congressional Black Caucus members of the House, where they state, and I quote, that as Black people, we know too well that US history is replete with processes, policies, and promises. We should stand in solidarity with the people of Puerto Rico in ways that fully allow them to determine their future, instead of a segment that has clearly shown that it is okay with anti-Blackness and shutting out its own people. The support of Black American groups in the plight for decolonization of the island and its right to self-determination is key. I will keep working with my colleagues from the Congressional Black Caucus to make sure the support for my bill continues to grow in their caucus. And to quote Lou Hamer, nobody's free until everybody's free.
Compañeros y compañeros. The organizers of this magnificent demonstration cannot be congratulated too many times. This is a truly historic meeting in solidarity with the struggle for Puerto Rican independence. We have to understand that when we raise the cry for the independence of Puerto Rico, it is not a question of abstract justice. It's a question of struggling for our own freedom. The freedom of Puerto Rico is the first condition for all of our freedoms. Black people, Asians, Indians, Chicanos, and all working people, whatever their color might be.
If you're doing your work properly, you have a feeling of where people want to go, what they're ready to do. And your role as a leader is to propose that they take that step. And that's the most valuable lesson I learned in the PSP. If you read it right and people are ready to do it and you take the step, they're going to follow. Part of our role in the United States was not only to organize Puerto Rican community around issues that affected us directly, but also mobilize around the independence of Puerto Rico. We did not see a difference between Puerto Ricans in the United States and Puerto Ricans, Puerto Rico, same nation. And so, you know, we wanted to draw those struggles together, looking for some spectacular way to do it. We were in this meeting. The head of the PSP in this country, Ramon Albona, looked at me and said, we have to find a big place, big place. Where are big places? So we said, you get the Manhattan Center. So how many does it hold? 3,000. He said, bigger. All right, and a couple of places in the Bronx, maybe hold 4,000 or 5,000. No, at the más grande. I said, well, you know, Ramon, this Madison Square Garden, that holds 20,000. And then I saw his eyes like light up. And he said, that's the one. I said, Ramon, it's Madison Square Garden. You don't fill Madison Square Garden with a political activity around the independence of Puerto Rico. And he said, what do you mean you don't? Nobody ever has. And he said, yes, but we're going to. And then someone will have. My job was to coordinate the action. You always got to organize your own solidarity. You got to organize everything with human beings. We organized solidarity committees nationwide. I was on a plane at least once a week, every week. I would go and I'd make a pitch. Why is Puerto Rico important to you? You know, Puerto Rico is important to you because your country maintains a classical colony. That's important as a military base, that's important as a portion of the US capitalist economy. And that's important because it gives this country the legal right to enslave another country. It's the legalization of imperialism. So the struggle of Puerto Rico is your struggle. Take it on or not, it's there. Now, keep in mind I'm 24 years old. I'm given the responsibility of coordinating the organization of the largest action in favor of Puerto Rican independence in the history of the United States of America. While I was confident that we could do it, I was also scared. Every night I would go home and say, are you sure I'm the guy that's supposed to be doing this? To myself. How did this happen, you know? But keep in mind, I had behind me one of the most powerful left-wing organizations of that period. The Puerto Rican Socialist Party organized with this vanguard concept. You know, you recruited into the party community leadership, people who were the most conscious in the community, most respected. And each of those people represented 10, 20, 30 people. Just need that one person. What we call the vanguard. And we did it through the newspaper, selling Claridad. They pay for the newspaper, and then you talk to them about some article or some action that's taking place. That's how we mobilize our base. That's how the garden action happened. It was a Sunday. The action was scheduled to begin at 12 noon. So the action starts. The garden is almost empty because they just started letting people in. Piri makes his speech. The lights go up and I look up at the thing and it's filled. I had never seen so many people in my life. It's hard to define what the greatest moments of your life are. I think like your birth would be, you know, like that, my kid's birth, my, you know, this and that. There are five or six of them. That's definitely one of them. That specific moment when I looked up and I saw the whole garden, Madison Square Garden, full. The main lesson of the Madison Square Garden thing is fundamentally, I think it's spiritual. Since that time, I have never had a second of doubt about the power of the human race to make fundamental change in this world and build a just and equitable society. That the human race is going to make a revolution. Never. You have to depart from the premise that everybody wants to make a revolution. Our job isn't to convince people. Our job is to show them how.
Thank you so much for making time to be with us today on this very special occasion of the anniversary of this historic event in Madison Square Garden. Could we begin with you telling us a little bit about how you remember that event and its importance?
Yes, Yarima. Well, thanks for the invitation. I'm sorry I wasn't able to be present at the same time with the other folks. But I think that the Madison Square Garden event in October of 1974 was really sort of the high point of solidarity with Puerto Rican self-determination in the United States. I actually was not at the event at the time because I was living in Philadelphia. I was still a member of the group that the Young Lords became, the Puerto Rican Revolutionary Workers Organization, in that year. And the organization was undergoing enormous upheaval and division. I just survived a major surgery that same weeks before, and I actually left the PRO right a couple of weeks before the October 1974 Madison Square Garden event. But it was clearly the high point of terms of spreading the word of Puerto Rico as a still remaining colony of the United States to the American public. So it had a major impact that way. And of course, it was followed a couple of years later by the Bicentennial Without Colonies protest in Philadelphia on the 200th anniversary of American independence, which was probably the largest protest, march and protest in support of Puerto Rican independence that has occurred in the United States. So those two events, really, both organized by the Puerto Rican Socialist Party, were critical. They created Puerto Rican solidarity or the committees around the country, and they really brought an entire generation of young Americans who knew nothing about Puerto Rico some new knowledge and understanding about the fact that our country was still holding colonies. And, you know, I think the members of the PSP, like the members of the Young Lords and El Comité MEMP, were deeply influenced by the anti-colonial struggles in Africa and Asia, especially some of the great writers and theoreticians, I think especially of Frantz Fanon and his Wretched of the Earth, and that great quote that perfectly captures a Puerto Rican reality, that where he said, "Colonialism is not satisfied merely with holding a people in its grip and emptying the native's brain of all form and content. By a kind of perverted logic, it turns to the past of the oppressed people and distorts, disfigures, and destroys it." And so it was people like Fanon and Amilcar Cabral and Kwame Nkrumah, who fired the imagination of young Latinos and African Americans back then, to say, hey, colonialism must end everywhere. And I think for the United States, that really meant ending colonialism in Puerto Rico, and of course led to gradually the creation of all the Puerto Rican studies and Latino studies programs, as people demanded that the universities change the nature of the kind of education they were producing in the colleges across the country. So it was a really important seminal period, that demonstration and those events.
Absolutely, and Centro itself is a product of that activism and of those struggles. Juan, can you talk a little bit about how within the movements like the Young Lords, or particularly the Young Lords at that time, what was the relationship between African-American social movements and organizing and Puerto Rican organizing? Were these two distinct groups, or how did they imagine that relationship?
Well, there had been for many years separate movements that had developed around the country. Both, you know, clearly there had been an independence and Puerto Rican nationalist movement in the U.S. and on the island. There had been the Black Liberation Movement. But what really started happening in the late 1960s and early 70s was that specific organizations and groups began to see the need to develop solidarity. And of course, with us in the Young Lords, it was particularly with the Black Panther Party. The Black Panther Party, which I still believe was the most important revolutionary organization in U.S. history, in that, with all due respects to W.E.B. Du Bois and to Paul Robeson and to Hubert Harrison and all the other great African-American leftists that existed in this country, it wasn't until the Black Panther Party arrived that ideas of revolution and Marxism were spread to the masses of people, not just to the intellectuals. And so the Panther Party and the Young Lords worked very closely together. We worked hand in glove wherever we had organizations and chapters. We worked together. And it wasn't just the Panthers. I mean, I think, and I'm sure James Early can talk about this, there were other organizations that saw the need to build, and groups that saw the need to build that kind of unity. There was the Che Lumumba Club of the Communist Party. There were labor leaders like the Harlem labor leader, Jim Houghton. There was Amiri Baraka in Newark, who after passing through a cultural nationalist phase, then became a Marxist and really saw the need to build solidarities and unities across ethnic and racial lines. There was Mohammed Kenyatta of the Black United Front in Philadelphia, who we worked closely with. And there was Mamia Abu-Jamal, former Panther, who I worked closely with for many years in Philadelphia. We all saw the need to work together to combat narrow nationalism in all of our communities, and to find the unities that held us together. I'll never forget in the early 80s, when I was a young reporter in Philadelphia, Mamia, who was also a reporter at the time, says to me, Juan, he became the president of the Philadelphia chapter of the Black Journalists in Philadelphia. And he said, Juan, I want you to join the Black Journalists Organization. So he brought me to a meeting of the Black journalists of Philadelphia. All there weren't many of them, 20 or so at the time. And there was immediate reaction. What's he doing here? This is an African-American organization. He's not African-American. Mamia goes into a rant about the history of colonialism in Puerto Rico, the unities between the Puerto Rican community and the Black community. And he insisted that this was the kind of organization the Black journalists need to be about. Unfortunately, he was the chair, but he didn't control the group. And so they would not accept me as a member. At that time, there was no Latino journalist organization. I then helped to found one, but it was the kind of viewpoint that Mamia and Kenyatta and Amiri Baraka had, to find ways to build solidarities, to fight imperialism, to fight capitalism, to better the economic conditions of all of our people. That's what they brought. And, you know, even before, and they understood that as a member of the Young Lords, for instance, people forget about 25% of the membership of the Young Lords, a Puerto Rican revolutionary organization, was African American. We always had not only African Americans, but especially throughout the group, Afro Boricuas played a prominent role. We had six people in the initial leadership of the Young Lords. Three of them were Afro Boricuas: Felipe Luciano, Pablo Guzman, Juan Fi Ortiz. One was an African-American woman, Denise Oliver. And two were light-skinned Puerto Ricans, myself and David Perez. It was unheard of at that time to have a Latino group with mostly Black leadership. And throughout the membership of the organization, it was the same way. So we were confronting issues of race, of sexism, of the need to defend the rights of gays and lesbians 50 years ago, long before it was fashionable to do so. And I think that that was part of our understanding of how imperialism affects the mindset of people, that we have to not only fight the system, we have to fight the biases that are inculcated in us by a racist society. But we always understood the difference between those individual biases that are inculcated in people and the systemic problems that we have to fight. We didn't mistake one for the other. We understood everyone has biases, but we're fighting a system. And we need to unite everyone to fight that system. So I think that that's what I think the critical role that the Young Lords played then was, actually in practice, fighting the racism in the society, the sexism in the society, but always with a view of, hey, our goal is this. Our goal is self-determination for Puerto Rico. Our goal is ending exploitation of all people, and of course, ending militarism and war abroad. So I think that's the kind of approach that we took, and we were lucky to have revolutionary and progressive African Americans who joined with us and said, let's fight this together. So I think that's the key lesson for today. Unfortunately, I think today some of our younger activists want to concentrate more on the differences than they do on the unities. They want to they prefer blasting someone on Facebook and Twitter than studying the history of how we got to where we are today, and figuring out the solutions to how we can build a stronger movement. So I think that that's the current generation has to understand that, one, this is not new. This is not the first time America has gone through a racial reckoning. In fact, it goes through a racial reckoning every generation. Because new generations come and they have to learn the thing all over again. But the issue is, how do we build stronger movements? How do we build, how do we decolonize Puerto Rico? Because Puerto Rico is more a colony of the United States today than it has been at any time since 1900, right? It is directly under the control of the US government now, as opposed to indirectly under the Commonwealth. So how do we find solutions to these problems? I think that's the big question that we still have to deal with.
Like you said, it's very remarkable to have had this Latino movement with such an Afro-Latino and Black leadership. Do you think, how does that contrast to anti-colonial movements within Puerto Rico? Has there been that tradition of Afro Puerto Rican and Black leadership in the island as well? Or do you think that was something unique to the diaspora experience?
I think that to some extent at that time, it definitely was unique to the diaspora experience, because we met with all of the leaders of the MPI and PSP at the time, with the Puerto Rican Independence Party, with the Nationalist Party. And there were some Afro Boricuas that were in the leadership of these organizations, but especially at the leadership level, were a distinct minority. And I think that some of the conflicts that we had back then were somewhat a result of some of those prejudices that existed, especially with the Puerto Rican Independence Party, because that was much more of an of a middle class and upper class party than was the MPI or PSP. So that I think that there were biases that were, and there were class differences. See, because understand that the Puerto Rican migration, we as the sons and daughters of the migrants of the 1950s were largely exclusively from working class backgrounds. There were no sons of professors or engineers or businessmen in the Young Lords. We were all the children of seamstresses and kitchen workers and taxi drivers so we were basically a working class organization or the children of the working class. And so it was a little bit different in terms of class and significantly different in terms of the racial composition of the group. But we always saw that as an obstacle to be overcome, not a basis to divide us. It was an obstacle that had to be overcome, and we tried to do it as best as we could in as fraternal a way as we could with the other organizations.
Amazing. Do you have any final thoughts about how we can build from these lessons into the present, or anything else you want to throw out to the panelists to pick up in the conversation today?
Well, I think the key thing to understand is that, times change, conditions change, and progressive and radical movements have to adapt and develop new strategies based on those conditions. You know, one of the things I've tried to emphasize, for instance, in the fight for decolonizing Puerto Rico, what does independence mean today? When the reality is that great powers no longer need to directly occupy a country to control it. They have all kinds of economic and financial means and means of surveillance, means of cutting off credit lines. They can control a country from afar. So the independence today no longer means what it meant 50 years ago. And therefore, small nations need to come up with new creative ways to maintain their sovereignty in a world that is increasingly interdependent and where borders are being broken down and capital enters and leaves a country in an instant. How do you defend your national sovereignty, your national culture in a world that is changing so rapidly? So I think that's the big challenge for those who want to decolonize Puerto Rico. What does decolonization mean in a world that is increasingly operating across borders? And that I think is the question that really nobody has solved yet. I certainly haven't solved it, and I think that I keep trying to figure out ways to solve it, but I think we need a lot of brain power to come together and figure out how Puerto Rico can move forward. Especially because, you know, when we were in the Young Lords, we used to say we were a divided nation, that one third of the Puerto Rican people lived in the United States, two thirds lived in Puerto Rico. That was 1970. Today, 5/8 of every Puerto Rican, of all Puerto Ricans on earth, live in the United States, right? The bulk of the Puerto Rican people now live in the United States, not in Puerto Rico. What does that mean? How do we deal with that? And I think that is the issue that we have to sort of grapple with and try to come to terms with. And how does that affect not only what happens to the Puerto Rican community in the United States, but what happens to the Puerto Ricans on the island?
What a great opening point for the dialogue, because indeed, you know, what does decolonization mean when we are really talking about internal colonies more than ever, right? And the kind of solidarity that Puerto Ricans need to have and cultivate with other minority groups in the United States is a bigger and more urgent question now than ever. So thank you so much, Juan Gonzalez. Hopefully we can have you back at some point at Centro but thank you so much for making time to join us virtually.
Okay, my pleasure. Take care.
Okay, once again, I want to thank first Congresswoman Nidia Velasquez and also journalist and Rutgers professor Juan Gonzalez for pre-recording their comments for tonight's event. Juan Gonzalez is actually teaching right now as we speak, which is why he was not able to join us in person. And I also want to thank once again the co-producers of the documentary that we previewed. This is a teaser for a documentary still in process about the Puerto Rican Socialist Party in the United States. And so again, thank you to the film's co-producers, Karim Lopez, Teresa Basilio, and Carmen Vivian Rivera. So now we turn to our panel discussion. And for this, I invite to our virtual stage, first of all, James Counts Early, who is the former director of cultural heritage policy in the Center for Folklife Programs and Cultural Studies at the Smithsonian Institution. Over the course of a 25-year professional career, Mr. Early has consistently recognized the integrity of historically evolved values and cultures of African-American, Latino, Native American, and Asian Pacific American communities. He has taught high school Spanish, worked with the incarcerated, taught at the college level, lectured in the US and internationally, and written extensively on the politics of culture. In addition, we have Ana Irma Rivera Lassén, who is a lawyer, feminist activist, and human rights advocate. Her activism has been focused on the fight against racism and discrimination against women, sexual orientation, and gender identity, among others. Her trajectory includes being a co-founder of several important organizations dedicated to these causes. In conjunction with Dr. Elizabeth Crespo Kebler, she published the book Documents of Feminism in Puerto Rico, Facsimiles of History. The book is about the feminist movements of the 1970s and is considered an important contribution to the study of the role of women in the history of Puerto Rico, the Caribbean, and Latin America. She is the former president of the Colegio de Abogados y Abogadas de Puerto Rico, the Puerto Rican Bar Association, and former president of the Movimiento Victoria Ciudadana, a political party for which she is currently minority whip and senator at large in the Puerto Rican Senate. And she's also president of the Senate Committee for Human Rights and Labor Matters. So thank you, Ana Irma and James. If you could turn on your camera, James, we can't see you right now.
Okay, empieza.
I don't know if James is having a technical issue. See, James, you need to turn on your video. I see you that you're connected here, but we can't see your image right now. Well, let me give James a minute to get sorted out, and hopefully our team, Kimberly and Jose Camacho, can assist James. Anairma, so let me start with you. Can you talk to us a little bit about your vision of, as a activist and advocate based in Puerto Rico, how you see the trajectory, the importance, and the challenges of African-American and Puerto Rican solidarity?
Okay.
And feel free to speak in Spanish, Anairma, because we do have translation available.
Bueno, estoy oyendo un poco mal, pero entiendo que me estás pidiendo que reaccione. Si ustedes me escuchan bien, pues continúo. ¿Sí? Antes que nada, quería reaccionar a lo que he escuchado hasta ahora, porque obviamente en los años 70 yo comenzaba los activismos míos feministas. Así es que un poco el año 74 en particular es un año muy importante, lo que se llama la segunda ola de los feminismos en Puerto Rico, fue cuando empezamos a celebrar lo que sería el 8 de marzo por las organizaciones autónomas, que no estaban vinculadas a ningún partido político. Y quiero reaccionar por ahí y llevarlo hasta la experiencia mía actual, un poco con el tema que se está conmemorando hoy, porque oyendo todo lo que estaba diciendo González y viendo el video, que estaba estupendo, me vinieron muchas cosas a la mente, sobre todo las tensiones que en esos años 70, y gracias al centro, gracias a Friends of Puerto Rico y a Boricuas Unidos en la diáspora por la invitación. Pero cuando estaba mirando todo eso, estaba pensando que en esos primeros comienzos de los años 70, específicamente, yo pertenecía a una organización que se llama Mujer Intégrate Ahora, que fue la primera organización autónoma de los años 70, de lo que se llama como la segunda ola de los feminismos, ¿verdad? Confrontó en Puerto Rico unas tensiones que me parece que están sobre la mesa en esta discusión. Y esas tensiones tenían que ver con cuál era la visión de cambio social que teníamos. Y si los feminismos, la lucha por los derechos de las mujeres, era algo puertorriqueño, o era algo que estaba impuesto por culturas como Estados Unidos o algo así, eran esas tensiones. Eran unas tensiones muy fuertes y de muchos ataques que sufrimos las feministas en ese momento por parte de una visión muy, muy, muy cerrada sobre que si uno no hablaba de la independencia, por usar un tema, pues no era suficientemente revolucionario el planteamiento, aunque estuviéramos hablando de una revolución completa, de una visión social completamente distinta. Y esas tensiones estaban ahí, oyendo a González, pues las recordé. En el caso de trabajar desde las islas de Puerto Rico, esas tensiones hacia los trabajos en la diáspora estaban ahí también. Las tensiones de no ver a Puerto Rico como una sola nación, desde las islas de Puerto Rico, la gente de la diáspora, una misma nación puertorriqueña, esas discusiones se estaban dando bien fuertemente en esos momentos. Y con respecto a la raza, sin duda, eran los años, de hecho el 74 es el año en que saca Isabel Ocenón su libro de Narciso descubre su trasero. Así es que esa discusión sobre cuán negro es el pueblo puertorriqueño y la afrodescendencia estaba ahí también. Y también una tensión muy grande de que en el caso de las islas de Puerto Rico, creo que la diáspora lo discutía quizás más fluidamente, en caso de la parte de la nación, en las islas de Puerto Rico, la parte de la nación de las islas de Puerto Rico se resistía a trabajar el tema de la identidad múltiple, la identidad racial de Puerto Rico, y la negaba, inclusive decía que Puerto Rico no era un pueblo racista. Y eso estaba ahí sobre la mesa en esas discusiones y nos azotaba a las mujeres que nos estábamos organizando desde los temas de los feminismos en Puerto Rico, porque decíamos en ese momento, y por eso recordando, oyendo lo que decía González, porque las que estábamos en esa organización en particular en ese momento decíamos que las luchas por los derechos de las mujeres atravesaban todas las luchas y que tenían que ser parte de las luchas por la descolonización de Puerto Rico, porque tenía que ser parte de una visión más amplia que incluyera también la lucha contra lo que ahora le llamamos los discrímenes contra la comunidad LGBTIQ+, que tenía que trabajar el tema, sin duda, de los temas de raza, que tenía que trabajar temas de una sociedad más inclusiva y más justa y equitativamente más hacia las necesidades sociales de las personas, sin que necesariamente estuviéramos hablando de que teníamos que hablar de impulsar el socialismo o algo por el estilo, sino una mirada bastante amplia donde cabían todas esas discusiones y se nos criticaba. Y yo creo que eso hay que decirlo porque fueron años muy intensos, muy fuertes, y nos atacaban de todos lados. O sea, nos atacaban las personas y los partidos que creían en la independencia, que nos decían que lo que decíamos de los derechos de las mujeres llegaría con la independencia de Puerto Rico. Nos atacaban las personas que creían en la estadidad, y nos atacaban también las personas que creían en el Estado Libre Asociado. Yo creo que esas tensiones, en muchos sentidos, lo que tienen que ver es con una de las grandes divisiones que tiene Puerto Rico todavía, y que es un poco contestando la pregunta que ustedes están haciendo, hacia dónde debemos movernos, tiene que contestarse. Y es que la gente, tradicionalmente aquí, se han dividido no solo los partidos políticos, muchas organizaciones políticas que no necesariamente son partidos, se han dividido solo en torno al tema de resolver el problema del estatus. Como si resolver el problema del estatus realmente resolviera la construcción del país que queremos. Desde entonces hasta ahora, mucha gente entendemos que el país que queremos debe construirse, no importa el estatus que Puerto Rico tenga. Es el país que queremos construir una sociedad inclusiva, una sociedad que no discrimine, una sociedad anti-neoliberal, como que queremos ahora, una sociedad que hable de defender el ambiente, una sociedad que impulse todo lo que tiene que ver con desarrollo sostenible. Esa es la visión del país que debemos impulsar, basada obviamente en una sociedad no discriminatoria, una sociedad inclusiva. eso tiene que ser parte de cualquier noción de país, no importa cuál es el estatus que uno esté pensando para Puerto Rico. Y creo que por ahí es que van las diferencias, un poco todas esas tensiones de los años 70, sin hablar todas las tensiones de discriminación hacia la comunidad LGBTIQ+. Y obviamente ustedes saben que yo siempre hablo desde las intersecciones, porque desde entonces hasta ahora he sido una persona que creo que la clave para avanzar está en reconocer las diversidades, no como división, sino como fuerza. Como fuerza, porque en la medida en que uno reconoce la diversidad, reconoce que la diversidad no es lo que nos divide, lo que nos divide es la no aceptación de las diversidades. En la medida en que uno reconoce que eso enriquece la noción de sociedad, y en la medida que uno impulsa la aceptación de las intersecciones, ya sea al interior de todas, cada una de las personas, que tenemos muchas, o como país, entonces yo creo que avanzamos en mucha más fortaleza. Yo siempre hablo desde todas las intersecciones, porque siempre he hablado como una mujer negra, como una mujer lesbiana, desde los años 70 hasta el día de hoy, y como senadora, que eso podríamos hablar en otro momento. Obviamente he pasado por muchas situaciones de activista y de muchas de las puestos que he ocupado en diferentes organizaciones, y ahora como senadora, donde siempre hablo desde las intersecciones y nunca dejo de decir que es importante que como país avancemos desde ahí, desde ese abrazarnos en nuestras diversidades. Fíjense que era tan fuerte el asunto que al final de cuentas, cuando salen las carpetas a las personas subversivas, pues las feministas también fuimos perseguidas, también nos hicieron carpetas. O sea que lo que estábamos hablando era suficientemente, le daba suficientemente miedo al status quo como para que también nos incluyeran solo por ser feministas en la persecución y en las carpetas famosas que se hicieron a muchas organizaciones. Así que yo creo que lo que estamos celebrando, que me parece fantástico, yo en esa época en mi casa siempre tenía un retrato de Angela Davis, recuerdo perfectamente eso, me parece que es una de las discusiones que hay que aterrizar al día de hoy en el Puerto Rico que tenemos ahora. Confrontamos en una junta de control fiscal, que si alguien pensaba que Puerto Rico no era una colonia, ya el hecho de aprobar la ley promesa y tener esa junta, y como lo que se aprobó anoche, esa barbaridad de aprobar el plan fiscal de la junta, pues es una reafirmación de la colonia en que vivimos. La salida de la colonia, pues ya eso es otra situación. Si el proceso de la salida de la colonia es el proceso de la Asamblea Constitucional de Estatus o cualquier otro proceso donde haya algún proceso vinculante con respecto al Congreso de Estados Unidos, ese es el proceso. En el Movimiento de Historia Ciudadana que yo estoy, creemos en el proceso, creemos que Puerto Rico es una colonia, y que la solución es el proceso donde se den las fórmulas descolonizadoras y que el pueblo de Puerto Rico realmente tenga la oportunidad de decidir con una, en una fórmula que sea vinculante con el Congreso de los Estados Unidos. Así es que me parece que por ahí podríamos llevar la discusión, pero no quiero dejar sin hablar una anécdota, y es que también una de las cosas que me pasó cuando me hicieron la invitación y empecé a mirar todo y viendo el video, es que la primera vez que yo fui a Estados Unidos fue en el año 1975, al otro año del evento. Yo nunca había viajado a Estados Unidos, así es que para mí era una aventura interesante. Y de las primeras cosas que más me impactaron, y recuerdo, era que realmente las personas que me veían no pensaban que yo era puertorriqueña, y eso es parte del asunto, ¿verdad? Yo soy afropuertorriqueña, evidentemente una mujer negra, y estoy hablando de todo el mundo que a lo largo de lo que yo fui a hacer a Estados Unidos, que fui a presentar El Tacón de la Chancleta, que era una publicación que hacíamos, me hablaban y me miraban. Cuando yo hablaba, abría la boca y hablaba, y se dan cuenta que yo hablaba con acento, que yo, mi primer idioma no era el inglés, se quedaban sorprendidas las personas. Así que ahí hay unos asuntos, ¿verdad? Yo me entendí, y no es porque Puerto Rico no hay racismo, porque sí que lo hay bastante, pero el racismo de mirarte y hablarte desde el punto de vista de cómo se trabaja el racismo de afrodescendencia en Estados Unidos, fue una lección muy, muy importante para mí. Y obviamente me ayudó a entender el racismo también de Puerto Rico, que se niega, y en Puerto Rico pues a base de las gradaciones de tonalidades de piel y todas esas cosas que sabemos que tenemos que confrontar. Reconocer el racismo de Puerto Rico, uno de los retos que tenemos también. Y para terminar, bueno, y parte de la anécdota, yo no sé si ustedes han visto por ahí una foto mía que sale, en estos días la he visto más con varios reportajes. Hay una foto que yo estoy conversando con Gloria Steinem en la parada de de Nueva York del 8 de marzo de ese año. Yo me la encontré en la parada, estábamos conversando porque ella había hecho unas visitas a Puerto Rico y había hecho unos donativos para unas publicaciones y estábamos conversando. Yo no sabía que habían sacado esa foto. Y en estos días estaba mirando la foto y porque la he visto en varios sitios. Y lo que me caigo en cuenta, obviamente la gente que ve la foto sabe quién es Gloria Steinem, no necesariamente sabe quién soy yo, salvo la gente que me conoce. Pero lo que yo estoy segura es que el fotógrafo pensó que ella estaba hablando con una mujer afroamericana, no necesariamente afropuertorriqueña. Y las personas afropuertorriqueñas, afrolatinas, afroamericanas, seguramente piensan lo mismo cuando ven la foto. Porque esa es parte de los retos, de conocer la diversidad racial y étnica de la gente de Puerto Rico y otras identidades nacionales. Reconocernos como una sociedad plurinacional, pluriétnica, y no importa cómo finalmente Puerto Rico decida cuál es el estatus que quiera, tiene que ser con una apuesta a una sociedad inclusiva y una sociedad que reconozca que los retos ya no son necesariamente el estatus, sino la sociedad que queremos vivir. Una sociedad que no sea neoliberal, que no sea racista, una sociedad que impulse desarrollo sostenible, una sociedad que impulse la solidaridad entre los pueblos. Esa es la sociedad que queremos impulsar, no importa el estatus que finalmente Puerto Rico decida. Y Puerto Rico es una sociedad en ese sentido plurinacional, igual que muchos países del mundo. Entonces, que ya hablar sobre todo esto como en los viejos moldes ya no se puede. O sea, los viejos moldes quedaron atrás y para avanzar hay que avanzar desde el reconocimiento de las diversidades, de las intersecciones y de sociedades plurales e inclusivas.
Gracias, Ana Irma. Puse en el chat un link a la foto que mencionaste de tu Twitter. ¿Me escuchas? ¿Me escuchas, Ana Irma?
No te escuché ahí casi.
No me escuchas, está bien, no te preocupes. Te voy a poner un comentario en el chat. Si le puedo pedir a Digna que vuelva al panel.
Ah, ya, que pusiste la referencia. Sí.
Sí,
ya lo vi.
Sí. Si Digna puede volver a, por favor, prender su cámara. Gracias, Digna. ¿Prefieres español o inglés, Digna?
Bueno, podía hablar Spanglish, pero
¿inglés?
Yo hablo más, puedo hablar los dos, pero me siento más cómoda en el inglés porque 63 años de mi vida fueron en Nueva York y se me hace más fácil. Okay,
but let me switch to English. Yes, our interpreter, even though we many of us live in Spanglish, our interpreter right. Would like us to choose one or the other so they can interpret for the communities who need okay. The interpretation. So Digna, I wanted to ask you, unfortunately, I don't know what happened with James. Maybe he will come back. I know, but if you could tell us a little bit more about your experiences during this time and how you viewed the questions of African-American and Puerto Rican solidarity. And I think some of Juan's reflections about, the role of Afro-Boricuas in the leadership among organizations in New York are important to reflect upon because I think as some of Ana Irma's reflections speak to this as well, this idea of a distinction between Puerto Ricans and Blacks as if these were two different communities, when in fact there's a lot of overlap and a lot of people who are both, right? So can you tell us a little bit from your perspective about this?
Well, you know, it's, as I mentioned in my opening remarks, those of us whose families brought us to the communities in the Northeast, I grew up in New York, were working class, and we grew up in communities that were shared with African Americans. And so that's the experience. And for many of us, a lot of our consciousness, and I'm talking now about late 50s, early 60s, was the civil rights movement. And we were very, very much affected by the civil rights movement. And, you know, several people have said, Juan, Ana Irma, desde la perspective, you know, the perspective from Puerto Rico, Puerto Ricans, when they first arrived, were viewed in many different ways, if you look at the literature of that time. But as someone who began in the 70s, late 60s, really, 70s, to become politically active, during that period of time, a lot of the activism was in conjunction with what was happening in Black communities. That's the reality. We didn't look to other communities because those communities were not involved on the kinds of issues that we were involved. We were in poor housing. We were being burned out in the Bronx and other parts of New York City. And so that's an experience that, so, you know, that's the situation that that I found myself in. But clearly, the comment that Juan made is a very true comment. For example, in the PSP, it was much more a multi-generational membership than the Young Lords, which was predominantly young people. I mean, we had young people and we were there, but we also had...
Se nos frizó, Digna. Let me see if we can get her back. Hopefully we can get Digna to unfreeze in a second. But let me start bringing in some questions from the audience. Pedro and Francisca Reyes asks, can someone address the possibility and need of a summit on Puerto Rico's decolonization and hooking it to a people summit where the Puerto Rican community at large can participate? Ana Irma, can you speak to us a little bit about from the perspective of Victoria Ciudadana and other political groups in Puerto Rico, a little bit more about what you were referring to before in terms of process and what kind of process or summit or, you know, how can we imagine what we need to move towards decolonizing Puerto Rico right now?
Oh, it came back on.
Thank you, Digna. I just asked this question that I'll put in the chat.
Okay, unfortunately, I went totally off screen.
Okay. Ana Irma, did you hear the question?
Sí, la tengo ahí, la estoy viendo.
Okay, sí.
Es que estoy pensando, porque okay. El movimiento Victoria Ciudadana, como creemos en que la nación puertorriqueña es las islas de Puerto Rico y la diáspora, uno de nuestros capítulos es la diáspora. Y es uno de los capítulos más fuertes que tiene Victoria Ciudadana y también defendemos que la participación de la diáspora esté en todo y también inclusive en el proceso que se dé para la, cualquier consulta realmente vinculante sobre la solución del estatus de Puerto Rico. Así que esa pregunta me trae a la mente algunas de las actividades que sé que tenemos que hacer en el caso nuestro, que tendría que ser una actividad grande sobre el tema de la descolonización en el marco más amplio que yo estoy diciendo y que cuente y se garantice la participación adecuada de todo el mundo de la diáspora y de la comunidad puertorriqueña en grande e inclusiva en todo sentido. Yo me voy a llevar la pregunta porque quizá lo que nos están es emplazando ya de que no solamente sea la teoría, sino que también sea la práctica y que hagamos algo realmente en esa dirección.
Gracias, gracias. Digna, do you have any thoughts on this question about the need for a summit on decolonization?
Are you asking me or Ana Irma?
I'm asking you, Digna. Mm-hmm.
Okay, yeah, well, I think absolutely. I think we should take full advantage of the situation that we find ourselves in and we should move ahead. And I am always, as someone who was for many years a community organizer, I firmly believe that that is the way that we need to move forward. And I would greatly support this and work for it. And I know that other organizations would also jump on board. We need to do this. We need to bring the voices of our, you know, local politics is also global politics, you know, and we need to bring our folks into that mix. So I'm all for that.
Sí. Fíjense que yo estaba pensando, es que la verdad es que gracias por invitarme a esta conversación, porque hay muchas cosas en mi cabeza revolcándose, mirando. Y una es que una de las cosas que hemos hecho en Puerto Rico, en las islas de Puerto Rico, no necesariamente en la diáspora, no en la nación puertorriqueña completa, es irnos mucho hacia América Latina y el Caribe, los movimientos sociales, movimientos feministas, movimientos de toda índole, y buscando la aceptación y la identidad nuestra de la parte latinoamericana y caribeña. Y un poco, ¿no?, dentro de los movimientos de derechos humanos, derechos los feministas, gay, dentro de Estados Unidos. Y eso a mí me parece bien interesante y tiene que ver con estas tensiones, ¿verdad? Con toda esta, si somos o no somos parte, o somos parte de qué y de qué manera. Pero eso es parte de las tensiones. Hacia América Latina y el Caribe, exigiéndoles que nos reconozcan como una nación latinoamericana y caribeña dentro de todas las cuestiones de Naciones Unidas, y usando los espacios de la sociedad civil como Puerto Rico. Y ahora yo creo que parte de lo que trae esta discusión es que no es solamente hacia América Latina y el Caribe, sino que hay que mirar la nación puertorriqueña en sentido más amplio y completo con la diáspora, y si nos movemos para América Latina y el Caribe, nos movemos como grupo. Y de hecho, esa ha sido también una tensión cuando hemos ido en algunas actividades de América Latina y el Caribe, cuando reclamamos nuestra diáspora, y no solo la diáspora de Puerto Rico. Es que quizás, como decía Juan, esa es la realidad de muchas naciones. O sea, la realidad múltiple y multinacional es la realidad de muchos países. Esa es la realidad ahora. O sea, ese asunto de dónde empiezan las naciones, eso ya se quedó. Eso se quedó en el pasado, de cómo se definen. Todos los países tienen diáspora, que es parte de sus identidades y parte de sus naciones. Así es que realmente tenemos que replantearnos algunas nociones geopolíticas y definiciones geopolíticas cuando estamos hablando ahora de estos temas. Y me parece que por ahí podría ser no solamente ese summit que están hablando, sino la celebración de hacia dónde va realmente ahora esta discusión en Puerto Rico y cuál es la discusión que Puerto Rico en todo el sentido, las islas de Puerto Rico, la diáspora, todo lo que es la nación puertorriqueña, cuál es la pregunta que Puerto Rico debe contestar en términos de su identidad y su destino.
Well, I'm going to ask one final question, putting together two questions that we've gotten. Miguel Fiol asks, it seems that Black leadership has distanced itself from Puerto Rico independence movement. Is that your perception? And if so, how do we get back on track? And Nicole Hernandez asks, what are the most obvious issues and intersectional links between Puerto Ricans and other minoritized populations in the US that Puerto Rican activists based in the US can focus on and help build bridges with? And she suggests perhaps public health, environmental racism, debt, education. So, you know, do you folks feel that the leadership of African-American movements in the US has distanced itself from independence? And whether yes or no, how do you think we can build more links of solidarity between Puerto Ricans and African Americans?
Well, I think there has been some what we can call a shift in emphasis because there is within the more structured and traditional civil rights organizations a sense that what they ask for Puerto Rico is within the context of the civil rights, that here are a people that don't vote for president and they should be able to vote for president of the United States. So there's a misconception in terms of what it means to be a colony. So that's something that needs to be focused on and more education occur. And I understand where that dynamic happened, but I think that it requires more of a, and I'll jump to the second part of what is listed here, and that is we need to have a lot more intersection of action between Puerto Ricans in Puerto Rico and different movements in the United States. On the feminist side of things, you know, I always felt that it was important that we bring, for example, I'm one of the founders in 83 of Madre, which is still exists today, a women's organization. We had several Puerto Ricans in there, but it was a multinational, multiracial organization. And those are important experiences. And that is something that needs to happen more and more, because that will help inform our solidarity that we get from other sectors in the United States, and will also enhance our understanding of how this effort to decolonize and where Puerto Rico is going to go in the future, you know, we will understand it much more clearly.
Gracias, Digna. Ana Irma, te dejo las últimas palabras.
¿Está hablando?
Sí, no sí, Ana Irma.
Ah, ok, es que no estaba segura si dijiste Digna o Ana Irma. Ana ok, Irma. Es que estaba leyendo la pregunta porque está compleja. Sí, porque yo no estoy segura. Si la, lo que hay que hacer es intensificar la relación expresamente y únicamente con el tema de la independencia de Puerto Rico. Yo creo que hay que, la colección tiene que ser con la descolonización de Puerto Rico y un proceso que realmente sea vinculante. Yo creo que en esa dirección, yo creo que es donde hay que avanzar. Obviamente, quien quiera apoyar la independencia, que la apoye, pero el proceso descolonización es más complejo y para que avance en Puerto Rico y que avancen las conexiones tiene que ir en esa dirección múltiple y reconocer que en esa dirección es que puede tener incluso un eco mayor acá en Puerto Rico, en las islas de Puerto Rico. Voy a estar siempre haciendo esa manera de decirlo. Por otro lado, yo creo que el tema de Black Lives Matter fue crucial en Puerto Rico, sobre todo con los últimos asesinatos racistas en Estados Unidos, no solo en Puerto Rico, en el mundo entero, pero lo que pasó en Estados Unidos, en Puerto Rico, en las islas de Puerto Rico, tuvo un impacto de jamaqueo muy fuerte y que yo creo que ayudó mucho al reconocimiento del racismo en Puerto Rico. Y hemos visto resultados buenísimos, como el resultado de las luchas que muchas organizaciones han hecho también con este trabajo en el último censo de Puerto Rico. Yo creo que eso podría ser otro tema, ¿verdad? Otro programa, otra conversación. Pero sin duda, yo tengo que reconocer que algún avance hemos hecho en reconocimiento de nuestra afrodescendencia y del racismo que hay que combatir en Puerto Rico. Así que esa conexión de por dónde hay que avanzar con las organizaciones afroamericanas en Estados Unidos con respecto a Puerto Rico, es la conexión de combatir el racismo en Puerto Rico y en la diáspora, en Puerto Rico, en la nación de Puerto Rico, donde quiera que esté la nación puertorriqueña. Esa es la conexión, porque esa conexión no tiene que ver con que si tú crees en la independencia, o crees en la estadidad, o crees en la República Asociada. Es el problema de esa manía de exclusión por razón de raza y el no reconocimiento de la afrodescendencia en Puerto Rico. Así que yo creo que por ahí es que tiene que haber mayor trabajo de solidaridad. Y no me quiere ir sin decir otra anécdota. A mí me encanta decir anécdotas. Yo recuerdo la visita de algunos compañeros y compañeras de los John Lords a Puerto Rico. Yo era estudiante universitaria en esa época y tengo que reconocer que yo lo vi con mucha curiosidad. Yo no entendía del todo, pero me fascinó la visita. Me parecía que estaban trayendo otra mirada. Me parecía que era importante lo que la presencia misma quería decir. Y yo sabía que algo estaba jamaqueándose en el país. Yo sabía que tenía que ver con esa noción de que Puerto Rico no era solamente las islas de Puerto Rico, que tenía que ver con esa noción de la inclusión de la diáspora en nuestra identidad, pero también sabía que tenía que ver con el sacudir qué es la identidad de ser puertorriqueño o puertorriqueña, esa noción de la identidad puertorriqueña que también se estaba sacudiendo ahí, que tenía que ver con que usted no tiene que hablar español nada más para poder ser puertorriqueño o puertorriqueña, que no tiene, que es más una cuestión de la identidad, no del idioma, ¿verdad? Entonces eso jamaqueó también, en muchos sentidos, la base más tradicional y estereotipada de esa noción de qué es ser una persona puertorriqueña. Y eso yo lo recuerdo muy bien. A mí, como una mujer joven que estaba en esas luchas, ¿verdad? Empezando todas esas luchas, y que a su vez sufría muchos de esos discrímenes, y sobre todo por ser feminista. Me parece que eso fue una experiencia que yo no la puedo olvidar, me parece muy buena, así que de verdad le doy las gracias porque me hizo recordar muchísimas cosas. Y creo que por ahí es que podríamos seguir avanzando. Vamos a avanzar en las conexiones de las luchas antirracistas, vamos a avanzar en las conexiones de las luchas anticoloniales, vamos a avanzar en todas las luchas que tienen que ver de la construcción de sociedades inclusivas. Y en esa medida podemos sumar mucha más gente.
Gracias, Ana Irma. Me parece que esos son un buen punto para terminar de cómo, para repensar la descolonización, la solidaridad, tenemos que repensar qué es lo puertorriqueño, ¿verdad? ¿Dónde empieza, dónde termina, cómo nos comunicamos y cuál es el rol de la diáspora en estas conversaciones? Así que ojalá podamos tener otros eventos para seguir este diálogo. Sé que se nos quedaron algunas preguntas sin hacer, le pido excusas al público por no poder incorporarlas todas, pero agradecemos a los panelistas y a nuestra audiencia, y sobre todo a Digna, que fue coorganizadora de este evento, por traer esta idea, y espero que sigamos conmemorando este día tan importante. Muchas gracias a todos.
Gracias.
Gracias.